intelligence. Stupidly, we bought into the theory that Mueller, who is the head of the Gestapo, who's not related, by the way, to Bob Mueller, the nice man who heads the FBI, as far as I know, a pretty nice chap. We had a meeting through an intermediary in the Justice Department a couple of weeks ago. Mueller, the head of Gestapo, Canaris, the head of the Abwehr, both faked their own deaths. Now, frankly, I think, Gary, we might have been a little more alert. Canaris, for example, was cremated. Not normally a good sign for an intelligence officer. The opposition had cremated. That's, that means there's no body to dig up. The only witness to Canaris's alleged execution at a concentration camp in Germany by the SS was Canaris's head of station in Copenhagen. Why anybody ever bought that, Harry? I don't know. The only witnesses to Canaris' death were people working for Canaris. And it was alleged that he was seen being executed from a hook through a knot, a wooden knot, that in new wood in the cell, and by reason of the expansion of the wood, there was a little hole, and it was possible to see this whole execution through the little hole in the cell door. I mean, why anybody bought to that, I don't know, but people did. One of the problems, of course, is that the headquarters of German intelligence was in the American zone, and the Germans controlled the OSS. So British intelligence got very little access down to Munich. Canaris faked his own death. He eventually died in 78. I've known people who have met Canaris post-war. I was involved in tracking down a photograph of Canaris in Colonel Whiting's. Whiting was another German spy inside OSS. Canaris virtually ran OSS. Donovan reported to him. The Dulles brothers reported to Canaris. So did Whiting. So did Richard Helms, who was in the Kennedy assassination. All the major players in OSS reported to Admiral Canaris. There are deep Vatican connections as well. Quite a few of them are Catholic. Donovan, for example, is a Catholic, and it's not just a straight reporting line to Admiral Canaris. There are also reporting lines into folks of the Vatican as well. It's not a straight German spy situation with Donovan. And, of course, he ran the OSS and was able to appoint and promote spies like the Dulles brothers. Now, I joked with the State Department when I was there last, which was a couple of weeks ago, I said, look, that time you guys renamed Dulles International Airport to the Von Dulles International Flughafen. But they didn't. They didn't quite. There was a rueful smile, Harry. I didn't get total agreement. I don't expect Dulles Airport will be renamed anytime soon. Now, the new agency was called, set up by Canaris, was called the Deutsche Verteidigungsdienst, or the German Defense Service. It had various cover organizations. One was the Deutsche Verteidigungsdienst, which was the German insurance office, and it used a number of German companies as fronts. It also has a number of front organizations. So the Trilateral Commission is one, the Bilderberg Group is another. So it works largely through front organizations. It stayed deep in the background. It was only exposed to me because I led the bid to save Rolls-Royce from our community partner, the Hun, no offense intended, in 98. And our community partners came after me, and German intelligence exposed themselves to me in 98, and I became aware of this secret little office based near the Augsburger Strasse in Dachau. The Germans then tried to murder me in 99. That's the sort of thing that gets your attention. You know what it's like, Harry. If someone tries to kill you, they get your attention. Nothing more irritating than a failed assassination attempt, apart from a successful assassination attempt, which, of course, can be jolly irritating. In terms of exposure to the UK, it was not really until 98, in terms of somebody like myself who was willing to stand up to them. There were people who knew about them before 98, but weren't willing to do anything about them, or were working for them, which was no good at all. Now, the German strategy after 45 was to maintain and seize control of Western political establishments using existing assets and recruiting new ones. They had brothels, for example, at Cambridge, Oxford, and in London. Typically, they have a male brothel and a female brothel, and the males would not necessarily concentrate on female spies. They maneuvered their own people into power in Washington and in London. They like control of the bureaucracies, and they like control of central banks, and they like control of intelligence. So Germany, from the DVD's perspective, if they're targeting, say, the UK, their aim would be not so much the armed forces, who are difficult to penetrate because they're full of honest people and people with high ethical standards. They would go for intelligence, they would go for the political establishment, easy, and they would go for the civil service and the central bank. So they're the four key targets, and all fairly soft targets, because they're full of people with private lives they wouldn't want disclosed, very easy to compromise into honey traps. Normally with the UK and America, it's honey traps. Normally with other countries, it's usually cash. Sometimes with Edward Heath, for example, is a combination of the both. He was caught in a honey trap with a gay lover at Oxford in 1937, but there was also quite a lot of money paid into his offshore bank accounts. Now, the second German strategy, apart from taking over countries covertly, was to sabotage. Otto Skorzeny was their key sabotage man. His boss was a man named General Lieutenant Erwin von Lahusen, and they would sabotage technological projects. The Germans have always been very opposed to progress, and any advanced program was going to be usually vulnerable to German sabotage. TSR-2 is a classic, sabotaged by a German spy named Roy Jenkins. But the Comet airliners, blown up by Skorzeny's people in Rome in 54, classic example. Lockerbie is another incident in the news recently where the Germans arranged to bring down the plane because the two intelligence officers on the plane were carrying evidence back to the United States of German-controlled drug trafficking via Frankfurt on Pan Am 103, which is a regular drugs pipeline, into the East Coast, with heroin refined in the Bekaa Valley from opium grown in the Bekaa Valley, all under control of the Germans. The Germans also concentrated very much on the Middle East because of oil and energy. They do understand energy. It was the Germans who set up the oil crisis of 73. The Ba'ath Party was set up by German intelligence, and both Syria and Iraq were essentially under German control. And the key players in Baghdad when Saddam Hussein was in power were Germans. And those in intelligence who were in Baghdad after 2003 tended to come across their name. So we know there were German assets there prior to 2003. Same situation in Syria. One of the reasons why Muslim terrorists get such easy rides in Germany. Munich Olympics, 72, easily sorted out. The Germans just let the guys in with the guns to murder the Israeli athletes. So oil, Middle East, terrorism. The Germans set up the Muslim Brotherhood in 28, and all the Islamic terrorist organizations can be traced back to the Muslim Brotherhood. And Germany controls, for example, Al-Qaeda, and Hezbollah and Hamas. Now, a huge amount of work has gone on in the last few years, particularly since 9/11, to sort out who was controlling Al-Qaeda. One of the frustrations, and I appreciate that the Marlborough Group know me, and you know I'm not going to lie to you, people listening on the internet A, may not understand intelligence, and B, don't necessarily know me. It is one of the frustrations for those not in the intelligence community, the usual response when somebody from within the intelligence community says X is true is where's the evidence? Well, the evidence is never revealed. Intelligence has three stages, and this is a classic analysis, but it really isn't any different now than it was when Harry was a young intelligence officer in fighting Rommel in the desert. It hasn't changed, frankly. The basics are still the same. Intelligence has three stages. There's collection, there's evaluation, and there's distribution. You can give them different names, but it's collection, it's evaluation, it's distribution. And in essence, today, I'm on the distribution side. I'm distributing intelligence. Its intelligence has already been evaluated and collected. Because many of the means are secret, they can't be exposed without losing the ability to collect further intelligence. You can't blow human assets. Those are the rules of the game. I can't give you names. I'm certainly not going to jeopardize anybody's life by saying I was provided with this intelligence by X. The rules slightly relax if someone is dead. So I can talk, for example, about General Dick, my good old friend, General Dick Walters, Vernon Walters, former deputy director of the CIA under four presidents, who was a colleague of mine, wonderful man. I worked closely with him, particularly after 9/11. We first started out on the Pinochet case, where we got General Pinochet back to Chile. I can talk about enemy agents I have interrogated. One of them was Marcus Wolf,